Follow me to the ends of the world. My goodness. Has any of you, been to Aspen or any other place where you have to schlep around with Harold and Diane? If you have, you would know that they don't follow me anywhere. I follow them. And frankly, at a considerable distance at times, and it's frankly at times annoying because Harold, you might not know it from looking at us, is considerably older than I am, and they are really a remarkable couple, and they're so compatible and so warm and so nice together. You just sometimes wonder what it is that makes some relationships so special. You agree, you shake your head. Is there something that we're missing? I mean, I argue and fight with my wife all the time, and it's hard for me to imagine the two of them fighting. Has anyone ever seen them fight? Raise your hand if you have. Well, you two don't count. In any case, good afternoon, and thank you for inviting me to speak. I've been told that the theme for this conference, Embracing Abundance, was chosen prior to what we might generously call a downturn on Wall Street. Had the conference been planned more recently, a more appropriate theme might have been Embracing an End to Abundance. Actually, despite the current downturn, it's a fitting program title. The concept of abundance, material, cultural, and spiritual, is relevant to all of us seeking to revitalize Jewish life in America. In this country, like no other, Jews have been freed from the restrictions that have hindered us elsewhere. As a result, the American Jewish community is probably the richest of any in our history. But the price of material abundance has been steep. Although the reasons for the decline in our spiritual life are complex and include an unwillingness of most of Judaism's leadership to adapt to changing times, it is clear that our material abundance, has gone up, our ties to Judaism have gone down. Judaism is not alone in this regard. In America, all religions, and indeed all immigrant cultures, have been subsumed by the dominant culture of commerce. But I would argue that Judaism is not just any culture, and the costs for us are especially acute. Our civilization, a civilization of spiritual and cultural abundance, born in exile and sustained through community cohesion for 2,000 years, is at risk of dwindling to a point of near irrelevance. Ultimately, it's fair to ask whether material abundance has in any way broadened, expanded, or helped our spiritual lives. When I visit with Birthright Israel participants, my excitement over seeing the spark of Jewish joy in their eyes is tempered somewhat when I realize how poor their Jewish educations have been. Indeed, one could argue that a crucial component of Birthright's success is the culture of shoddy Jewish education. Compared to what they knew or what they don't know or feel, perhaps it wasn't a great miracle to create a Jewish spark. On the other hand, Birthright offers some important lessons on the most powerful methods of Jewish education. Birthright Israel is experiential. Participants take part in the tactile history and the rich land of the Jewish people. Birthright Israel is social. It brings together Jews in the diaspora for a shared experience. and it mandates shared experience between diaspora Jews and Israelis in the form of mifkashim. Mifkashim is the experience where Israelis, mostly soldiers, join the buses and the trips in general with the participants for most of the time, and for many of the kids on the trip, this is a highlight. Finally, Birthright Israel is spiritual. I don't mean spiritual in terms of organized prayer. Some trips do include this. By spiritual, I mean that Birthright Israel connects young people, in many cases for the first time, to an experience of Judaism that is not connected to material life. I am thinking, for instance, of participants visiting the graves of 20-year-olds and realizing that if not for an historical accident, those kids who died protecting their country might have been them. They see the heroism and the sacrifice. They see lives lived for a purpose greater than themselves, and it sparks something in them. They realize that Judaism is special in a way that's impossible to articulate. They go to Masada and they are connected in intangible ways to their ancestors 2,000 years ago who sacrificed to keep their people alive. Many of these participants are living lives of material abundance in the diaspora, and they never had occasion to experience the spiritual abundance of their own tradition. How can we replicate such moments in our own Jewish educational institution so that Judaism is felt as a living and breathing culture with the capacity to inspire? Given the theme of this conference, there's another aspect of Birthright Israel trips that bears mentioning. The trips are free. This is the most revolutionary aspect of Birthright Israel, and it's an aspect that made the program controversial from the start. Diaspora Jews are living in abundance, the critics cried. Why should a community pay for rich kids to go on a trip? But it was the very gift of Birthright that helped dislodge participants from their impressions of Judaism as lifeless and cold, as a religion that asked for donations but gave little in return. Naturally, it made no sense to give something for free to people, many of whom could afford to pay for the experience themselves. But it was this very senselessness that led to a spiritual breakthrough. Participants were not only grateful, but they recognized that there must be something truly precious about Judaism if the community valued its young members so much that it would carry them across the world to experience their homeland. We should keep in mind that most great breakthroughs in Jewish history, including Herzl's vision of a Jewish state, were considered senseless when they first appeared. The Harold Grinspoon Foundation's PJ Library also understands the value and potential of a free gift. For many parents associate Judaism mostly with high costs and obligation. The PJ Library offers another route, thus instilling vital bonds at a critical stage in a parent's and a family's development. By providing age-appropriate Jewish books to families with young children, the program reaches new parents at a crucial stage when they are seeking ties to community and connections to their culture.